Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Ever Merciful, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise is due to Allah, the Lord Creator and Sustainer of all things. Wassalatu wassalamu ala ashrafi khalqillahi ajma'in. And may Allah raise the rank of and grant peace to the Messenger of Allah, the very best of the creation of Allah, Nabiyyina Muhammad, our Prophet Muhammad, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, and likewise all of his family and companions in entirety. Tonight we have in front of us in our 130 hadith class here at Al-Masjid Al-Awwal in the city of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and online with our respected brothers and sisters wherever they may be. May Allah Ta'ala bless them and grant them success. We have a study of hadith number 72 this evening, and this is the evening preceding the 22nd day of Jumada al-Akhirah, or Jumada al-Thaniyah, or Jumada al-Ukhra. All of those are the names of the second Jumada month. The months come in pairs. There's two Jumadas and two Rabi'as. There's Rabi' al-Awwal, Rabi' al-Thani, and Jumada al-Ula and Jumada al-Thaniyah. So we're in the fourth of those 4 months, subhanAllah, right before the sacred month of Rajab al-Mudar, the Rajab of the famous Mudar tribe, Rajab, the seventh month, Naam. And so we are also 2 months and a week away from Ramadan. Allahumma balighnahu bis-siha wal-afiyah. We ask Allah Ta'ala to reach Ramadan in safety and in good health. Our study tonight is the study of hadith number 72. And that is in your workbooks on page 104. وَعَنِ بِنِ عَبَّاسٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمَا. And my Arabic printing of Ithaf al-Kiram has some strange errors in it. Do you see that? وَعَنِ بِنِ عَبَّاسَ. What is Abbas مَمْنُوع مِنَ الصَّرْف? وَعَنِ بِنِ عَبَّاسٍ. Naam, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمَا. May Allah be pleased with him and his father. قَالَ, he said, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Messenger of Allah, may Allah raise his rank and grant him peace, said, مَنْ تَسَمَّأَ حَدِيثَ قَوْمٍ وَهُمْ لَهُ كَرِهُونَ صُبَّ فِي أُذُنَيْهِ الْآنُوكُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Whoever listens to the discourse, the discussion of any people, whoever listens to a conversation of any people, any haditha qawmin mutlaq, any people, any conversation of any people, wahum lahu karihun, and they don't like that from him, meaning they are not pleased with him listening to their conversation. What do we call that in English? Eavesdropping, yeah? Stealing a listen, you know? Eavesdropping. Subba fi udunayhi al-anuk. Then, anuk will be poured into his two ears. Yawm al-qiyamah, on the day of judgment. What's anuk? Anuk is ar-rasas. It's lead. Lead is, in this life as we know it, poisonous, toxic to the human body. In this life, imagine the boiling lead of the hellfire. We ask Allah Ta'ala for safety with him. Anything poured in your ears that is toxic. You pour bleach in someone's ears, it's not even toxic. You can ruin his hearing. You pour things in people's ears. Anything that goes into the ear, it can be a real quick infection and can destroy your hearing. Anything. And even water. Swimmers know that even a few drops of water left in the ear canal can create an abscess or a problem. You know? Anything left in the ear canal is very, very sensitive. SubhanAllah. In the day of judgment, when people are made to be large, people are, the sizes of their bodies are enlarged for punishment. We ask Allah Ta'ala for safety and refuge. SubhanAllah. Imagine having hot lead poured in the ears. That the ya'ni ar-rasas, the lead of the hellfire. Akhrajahu al-Bukhari. It was collected by al-Bukhari. So a discussion, a quick discussion of two important people as we go into this study. The companion who narrated the hadith and the collector who put this hadith in his source book. So Ibn Abbas is the companion. His first name was Abdullah. Naam, and he was the son of Abbas, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ibn Abdul Muttalib. So when we say radiyallahu anhuma, we mean the Ibn and the Ab. Ibn Abbas We mean Abdullah himself, the Ibn, and Abbas, the father. Both were companions. Radiyallahu anhuma. May Allah be pleased with both of them. Abdullah ibn Abbas, from the greatest of the companions. The most premier scholar in a certain science. Tafsir, barakallahu feek. Tafsir of the Quran. What's the reason for that status that he holds? A special dua that was made for him, and as far as we know, not for others of the companions. And that dua was for two things. Allahumma allimhu at-ta'wil wa faqqihhu fid-deen. Oh Allah, give him knowledge of ta'wil. Ta'wil is tafsir, a synonym for tafsir, explanation of the Quran. Give him knowledge of the Quran. And faqqihhu fid-deen, give him fiqh in the religion. Give him understanding of the religion. And Allah Ta'ala answered the supplication of his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and made this young man, who was about 13 years old at the death of the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, not yet or just about to arrive at puberty, at adolescence, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed. He was in the time of Umar, still a teenager. 2 years of Abu Bakr's caliphate, and Umar would bring him in as a senior consultant at the age of 15 or 16 and beyond, along with the elders of the people. The elders of the tribes would come in and Umar would take consultation from the people, all of the elders and Ibn Abbas, a teenager. They would complain and they would say, if it's about bringing teenagers and children, we all have children, we can all bring our children to the majlis. They would complain about Abdullah ibn Abbas being there. And so Umar wanted to teach them a lesson one day. So he asked all of the elders about the tafsir, about the meaning of إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. What's the meaning of this? The first verse of Surah Al-Fath, or Al-Nasr, sorry. Not Al-Fath, but Surah Al-Nasr. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. When the aid of Allah comes and His victory. What's the meaning of this? The elders all agreed that it means the conquering of Mecca and the spreading of Islam after the conquering of Mecca. And they weren't wrong. But that's a very obvious tafsir. La yakhfa ala ahad. That's not hidden from anyone. Sathi. Everybody can see it from the words directly. Ibn Abbas said, it's an ishara. It's a hidden indication that the death of the messenger was soon to follow. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Where did he get that from? Subhanallah. From his insight. From his knowledge of tafsir that Allah granted him. From his study of tafsir under the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. From the principles and foundations that he learned. He knew prophethood and messengership was like this. If the mission is accomplished and the victory of Allah is here and Islam is spreading, then the messenger's mission, his purpose in life is accomplished. He doesn't remain in this life. The nature of the prophets and the messengers, they generally did not get to sit back after mission accomplished and enjoy the fruits of what they had done in this life. That's for the hereafter, as Allah Ta'ala has preferred that for them in the hereafter. So Ibn Abbas understood that that is the end of the mission, so that means our messenger will be taken very soon. So he understood an ishara, an underlying reference to something that not everyone can pick up on, only someone who's looking at the verses, not just from the surface level, but what's behind the lines and all of that. When did Ibn Abbas die? 71? Check your book. We have three narrations, I believe. Three narrations previously in this book by Ibn Abbas. What's the first one? It's in the first 10. It's the hadith about when you eat, don't wipe your hand until you lick it or have someone else lick it. That's the hadith of Ibn Abbas. That's hadith number 6, barakallahu feekum. Do you have a biography written there in your workbook for him that tells you the date of his death? You didn't write the date of death. Allahu Akbar. You wrote 68, ahsant. Barakallahu feek. Skip to the second occasion where his hadith is. We've got three hadith that we've studied already from Ibn Abbas. How are you finding these narrations? Huffaz antum. You've memorized all these narrations. Allahumma barik wa zid. You're using the index in the back, page 196, yeah. Page 196, go to the back of your books, you find your index. Ibn Abbas has another hadith. Number 35, that's that famous hadith, it's in the Arba'een. What is it? Ya ghulam, inni u'allimuka kalimatin. Oh young man, I'm going to teach you some words. So go to hadith 35. Do you see a date of death written there? 68, barakallahu fiikum. And you can look at the other reference if you couldn't find it. This is how you rehearse and review your biographies and you keep your information fresh, right? Go back and look at the narrations you've studied. Is this the first hadith of Ibn Abbas or have we studied others earlier? Connect the meanings and the stories to the companion. It helps you understand that companion. Oh, he's the one who narrated. Don't wash the hand off before licking it. He's the one who narrated. If you ask anyone, then ask Allah. He's the one who narrated this hadith and that hadith. Tayyib, so he's our narrator today. He died in the year 68. Akhrajahu al-Bukhari. This hadith was collected by al-Bukhari. His name? Muhammad. His father's name? Ismail. His nisbah to his land? Al-Bukhari. His nisbah to his qabila? Al-Ju'fi. His kunya, his parental nickname? Abu Abdullah, barakallahu fiikum. His rank amongst the hadith scholars? You could say, daraja al-una, the first top rank, the highest ranking imam of the imams of hadith. What year did he die? 256, barakallahu fiikum. So there's our hadith, a very straightforward hadith. Whoever does such and such, he has such and such punishment. Right? This is min nusus al-wa'id, from the texts that warn of punishment against sins. And as a principle, remember, any action that is mentioned in a text of the book or the sunnah as having a specific punishment in the hellfire for whoever does it, then we know that that action is kabira min kaba'ir al-dhunub, a major sin, something that is not easy, not light, not something to skip over, not something to take lightly, something to take very seriously. So let's not overlook the importance of tonight's hadith. It is a prohibition of eavesdropping. And the hadith is authentic, or is there a problem with it, or what do you think? It's in Sahih al-Bukhari, so there's no reason to discuss its authenticity. Let's go right now to the explanation of Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan al-Fawzan in his book called Ithaful Kiram. I'm on page 200 of that book. It's also in the seventh volume, the final volume of his Arabic, the Arabic printing of his explanation of the entire book, Bulugh al-Maram as well, if you have that collection. He says, هذا الحديث فيه تحريم الاستماع إلى كلام الناس. In this hadith, there is a prohibition of listening to the speech of people. الذين لا يحبون أن يستمع إليهم. Those who do not want to have their words listened to or their conversation heard. Alladhi, look what it says. Read that word. Alladhi yatanassatu. Yatanassat. What's in the original asl, Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan said, yatasannatu. Yatasannatu. Naam? Means the one that yastariq as-sama. He eavesdrops. He listens in. Alladhi yatasannatu. As Sheikh Fawzan said it.
اللي تصنت على الناس توحى على الجيران على المتحدثين.
على الناس, the one that eavesdrops on the people. على الجيراني, the one that secretly listens in on the neighbors. وعلى المتحدثين ماذا يقولون. He listens to any people who are talking. What are they saying? What are they talking about? من أجل أن يخبر عنه, in order to possibly pass on information about what he heard so and so saying. هذا عليه وعيد شديد. This kind of person has a heavy, severe threat against him. The threat of hot lead being poured in his ears. Subhanallah. تسمع أي استمع إلى حديث قوم. To listen to the speech of any people, يعني كلام الناس. Anybody's talk, the speech or the talk or the dialogue of any people, وهم له كارهون, and they are people who don't like that. They have not agreed to that. They are not okay with him listening. كارهون literally means They dislike that. يَكْرَهُونَ أَنَّ أَحَدًا يَسْمَعُهُمْ They dislike that people, that anyone would be listening to them. أَمَّا إِذَا صَارَ الْحَدِيثُ عَلَانِيَةً However, if the speech is open and out in public, and people are talking openly and clearly don't mind that others are listening to what they're saying, then what do you think? وَلَا يَكْرَهُونَ أَنْ يَسْمَعَهُ النَّاسِ And they don't seem to mind that any one of the people is listening to them, then لَا بَأْسِ There's no problem in listening to people talk publicly, openly, those who are talking clearly and have no indication that they dislike being heard. إِنَّمَا إِذَا كَانُوا يَكْرَهُونَ هَذَا However, it's only when they dislike that and they don't want to be heard. لَا يُرِيدُونَ أَنْ يَسْمَعَهُمْ أَحَدٌ They don't want anyone to hear what they're saying. فَمَنْ خَدَعَهُمْ وَتَسَمَّعَ إِلَيْهِمْ So whoever deceives them and then listens in on what they're saying, وَهُمْ لَا يَدْرُونَ And they don't know, whilst they don't know that, مِنْ أَجْلِ أَنْ يُفْشِيَ سِرَّهُمْ In order to maybe hear about a secret thing and spread that secret information, وَيَنْقُلَ كَلَامَهُمْ And maybe transmit their speech or share it with others, فَإِنَّهُ يُصَبُّ فِي أُذُنَيْهِ الْآنُكُ Then he shall have hot lead poured into his ears. وَفَسَّرَهُ الرَّاوِي بِأَنَّهُ الرَّصَاصِ And the narrator of the hadith has explained it as الرصاص, lead. آنُك is lead. وَقِيلَ الرَّصَاصُ الْمُذَابِ That is melted lead. Melted lead, you know, hot, you could say molten lead. When you heat the metal up so high that it's burning and hot, and it doesn't have a specific shape, it's like a liquid, it's so hot. وَلِعَاذُ بِاللَّهِ And refuge with Allah is sought, وَهُوَ شَدِيدُ الْحَرَارَةِ And this is something that would be extremely hot. الْأُذُنَانِ أَلَّتَانِ خَانَتَا فِي الدُّنْيَا The two ears that were betraying in this worldly life, ears that betray, meaning ears that betray a conversation that was not meant for them. وَاسْتَمَعَتَا إِلَى حَدِيثِ النَّاسِ And they listened in to the conversation of a people. الَّذِينَ لَا يُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يُسْمَعَ كَلَامُهُمْ Those who do not like that their speech is heard. يُصَبُّ فِي أُذُنَيْهِ اللَّتَيْنِ سَمِعَتَا هَذَا الْكَلَامَ الْآنُكُ Then it is poured into those two ears, those that heard this speech. آنُك hot lead. وَهَذَا فِي النَّارِ وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ And this is in the hellfire. And refuge with Allah Ta'ala is sought. That is the end of the explanation as printed here of Sheikh Saleh ibn Fawzan al-Fawzan. But the original recordings that this is a transcript of goes on. And for some reason, the remaining explanation, which is very good and has some additional benefit here, has not been included. And I'll add it on at this time. He added, فَهَذَا فِيهِ
وَعِيدٌ شَدِيدٌ
This has in it a serious threat of punishment. A person is not to listen to the conversations of the people. If a person sees two people talking, he should not approach them. He should not come close to them. He does not listen to their speech.
حتى يستأذن منهم فإن رآهم يتحدثون ولم يأذنوا له يبتعد عنهم
Until he seeks their permission, meaning to come close and listen. If he sees that they're talking and they don't give him permission, they don't gesture to him, come on over, it's no problem. If they don't give him permission to come listen, he stays away from them. He just keeps back, then he doesn't approach them. He lets them have their conversation.
وأشد منها اللي يجي على غره
And what's worse than this, or more severe as a violation, the one who goes to like a hidden place. He takes a strategic position in order to hear what he's not meant to hear. في مكان خفي, in a hidden post or a hidden place.
يجي على غرة في مكان خفي, يتسمع للناس أو الجيران.
And he listens to the people, or he listens to neighbors.
هذا عليه وعيد شديد. المسلمون لهم حرمة.
This one has a severe threat of punishment upon him because the Muslims have a limit that is to be observed as it relates to their honors. and their reputation, their private discussions and all of that. There's a sanctuary there. There's a limit you're not supposed to cross. So it's not allowed to transgress that, to transgress against them and to spread their private matters. And that ends the discussion of Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan from the original recording. And I'd like to add a few points here and pose a couple questions to you for understanding to make sure we got it. First of all, there's that principle that we've heard so many times referred to, where something is done as a crime and the punishment resembles the crime or is relative to the crime itself. Or there's a reward offered and the reward is something similar to the good deed done. What's that principle called? Ahsant ya Sultan. Al-jaza'u min jinsil amal. The recompense for a thing is of a like nature. It's similar to the action performed. Allah Ta'ala poses this rhetorical question. Hal jaza'u al-ihsani illa al-ihsan. Is the recompense for good treatment other than good treatment? Meaning when you return to Allah as a muhsin, may Allah Ta'ala make us from the muhsineen. You return to Allah after living a life of proficiency in your worship, and you did not worship others along with Allah, and you followed the sunnah of His Messenger with sincerity, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then hal jaza'u al-ihsani illa al-ihsan? Will there be a recompense for you other than grace and kind treatment and benevolence from Allah Ta'ala? We ask Allah Ta'ala for that. But if you approach Allah Ta'ala on the Day of Judgment after being treacherous, after being a betrayer, after being a liar, after being insincere in your worship, after being a show-off, after being hypocritical, after falling into major sins, and all of this, then the recompense is of a like nature. Subhanallah. If you have shown up on the Day of Judgment being an eavesdropper, being so frivolous with your attention that you try to focus on something and you hear two people talking over there and you stop what you're doing because you're fuduli. You just like to pick up on whatever's going on. What are they talking about? And instantly, whatever you are doing is not important. And the shaitan has made this over here important. I have to find out what's going on between these two people. This shows what? Da'ful iman, weakness of the iman. From iman is what? Al-hirsu ala nafi', to be vigilant about what benefits you. You want to be a strong believer from the hadith of the strong believer, right? Ihris ala ma yanfa'uka wasta'in billah wa la ta'jaz. Be vigilant about all matters of benefit and seek the assistance of Allah and don't be lazy. That's a strong believer for you right there. So the weak believer then what? Yihris ala ma la yanfa'uhu. He is vigilant about things that are not beneficial for him. Oh, those two are talking? I wonder what they're talking about. It looks interesting. And he becomes extremely interested in that. We've had a hadith that we've studied previously in this series that's very important about a person's good Islam. Very relative here. You know, a hadith that would stop the eavesdropping in its tracks. No one would eavesdrop if they practiced this earlier hadith. Ahsant, ahsant. Min husni Islam al mar'i. Tarkuhu ma la ya'nihi. From a person's good Islam is his abandonment of all things that don't concern him. So what's the correct answer to, I wonder what those two guys are talking about over there? La ya'nihi, none of my business. As a default rule, whatever the brother in the back just said to the brother in the back, none of my business. Keep your heart clean. It has nothing to do with me. Don't let the shaitan play with you. He's probably talking about me. Don't let the shaitan play games with you. Right? What they are saying to each other is none of my business. And my good Islam is actualizing that and having no concern for it. So when the shaitan makes it interesting, oh, what I wonder, what is he saying to him? Then you say what? A'udhu billah. Seek refuge with Allah Ta'ala, because the shaitan is distracting you into a matter that right now, it's just a weakness in your focus as a believer. But it could turn into a violation of today's hadith. What if I became so interested in what they're saying to each other, I decide to, you know, just sit a little closer so maybe I can hear what they're saying. Now what's going to happen? I deserve to have hot lead poured in my ears. I'm trying to listen in on a conversation that was not meant for me and that I'm not included in and I don't have permission to be involved with. Barakallahu feekum. What about? Does it have to be two people? Can you see a person on his phone? Imagine our brother Hanif over here has his phone. And so I decide I want to go over there and sit next to him and see what's going on the phone. What do you think? Could I apply today's hadith to that? Naam, it doesn't have to be two people. It can be a written message. Old-fashioned way, he has a risala. He just wrote a letter to someone. And he put it down and he went to go make wudu or something. So what would be the ruling now on me going and picking up the paper, unfolding it, and looking to see what he wrote to whoever he's writing to? This is eavesdropping, but it's not with speech. Now it's with written words. So what if I go look on his phone and then he's talking with his wife? He's sending a text message to his wife. Look what I just did. Why would I look on that screen? I lost my vigilance. I've lost my vigilance as a believer. I lost the strength of my iman. I've lost my good Islam. When min husni Islam al mar'i tarkuhu ma la ya'nihi, from the good Islam of a man is leaving alone the things that don't concern him. So looking on someone's phone, looking at someone's letter that he wrote to someone, reading someone's email, anything like that. You come onto a common area computer or something and someone didn't sign out of their email, what do? You close it up, hit the close button, don't pay any attention to what's on there. And don't take the opportunity to rifle through the kind of things that he was looking at. Leave it alone. Because all of that is from your strength as a believer. All of that is from your good practice of Islam. And these are the manners that we are learning in these classes. 130 hadith on manners, subhanAllah. So that hadith is so pillar, it's so important. A man's good practice of Islam is that he leaves alone the things that don't concern him. Some of the scholars said that hadith is one of four hadith that will suffice a man for his entire religion. That's how serious that issue is. That you are focused enough to not be distracted into things that don't concern you. That is a very key hadith in the foundational manners of this religion. Where is that hadith in our collection? Later than 16. Use your index and find it. 38? 38. It's the hadith of who? What's the companion who narrated it? What's his name? Abu Huraira, radiallahu anhu. Who collected it? At-Tirmidhi. Naam, there it is. Hadith number 38 in the book. And you can review our study of that hadith from the recorded lessons, as that hadith is extremely important in this religion. Again, from the 40 hadith of An-Nawawi, every hadith is extremely important. From the 4 hadith that Imam Abu Dawood and others said, these are the 4 hadith that will suffice a man for his entire religion. These 4 hadith alone, this being one of them. SubhanAllah. I want to remind myself and all of you that from the principles of punishment is fairness and justice in punishment. A body part in the hellfire can be specified with torture. Certain body parts will be punished because of the involvement of that body part in a sin committed. What's the evidence for that? This hadith, today's hadith. Hot lead poured in the ears. What part of the body was used to disobey Allah? The ears. Barakallahu feekum. Naam. So, scenario here. After Jumu'ah, you are sitting in the masjid and you hear a bunch of brothers talking outside in the masjid loudly. Are you allowed to continue listening? Yes. Nafis says yes. You think maybe not? No. He says no. Why not? Not your business. Okay. He's just going to avoid it because it's not his business. Abu Maryam is saying, this is based on what Shaykh Al-Fawzan said is not a problem. He said about this la ba's, meaning this doesn't fall into the prohibition. It's still better to just ignore it. If you're reading Quran or making dhikr or doing something virtuous, certainly it's going to be better for you to continue in that and not pay it any mind. But it's not sinful to listen because why? It's out in the open. It's after Jummah in front of the masjid. It's so loud, obviously, that it can come inside of the masjid. So it's clearly not intended to be secret or sensitive. But what if you're sitting here and on the other side of the wall, you hear two brothers come together and say, hey, listen, Akhi, between me and you, I need some advice on something. This is the beginning of the conversation. And they don't know you're sitting right here. And a lot of places in this masjid could actually match this situation. We have a lot of walls and nooks and places where a person could sit and not realize that some people just came together and said, hey, I need your advice on something between me and you. What do we do here? Move away. Yeah? Okay. What else might you do? You might say, hey, I can hear you guys. You might want to go somewhere else. Alert them that they are not alone. Yeah? Oh, there you go. Ahsant, ya Aba Maryam. Our brother reminds us, for example, sometimes at the end of a lecture, the microphone is forgotten and it's left on and the broadcast is going on. Or the microphone is on and the sisters can hear someone come, Brother Abu Abbas, I have a really important private question. Can I ask you this? And it's whispering. And obviously we've forgotten the microphone is here. Then what do our sisters do? Bang on the door and send a message over to us that, hey, the microphone is still on. Because why? We honor the reputations, the privacy of our brothers and sisters in Islam. That goes between males and females and all of that. So you find a cell phone in the masjid. The cell phone has a text message open. Then what do? You don't look at the text message. You don't read the text message. You maybe put the phone in a common place, like on the top of the shoe rack, so that people can find it when they come back to look for it. And you don't busy yourself with what's on that phone. What about the father who's responsible for those under his care, regarding his wife, regarding his children? What if he checks their emails? What if he looks on their phones for the purpose of what? Watching after his flock. Permissible. There's a difference. Who's that? Wajib. Abu Ahmed says, wajib, obligatory. Sheikh Saleh al-Fawzan, he was asked, what's the ruling on a father checking on his son's cell phone and his internet usage and things like that? Is it spying? Is it tajassus? Wala tajassasu, you know, don't spy on one another, don't listen in. Is it this, you know, hearing the speech of people that they don't want you to hear?
فضيلة الشيخ وفقكم الله يقول السائل هل يجوز لي كوالد أن أفتش في جوال وكمبيوتر أبنائي خشية أن يكون فيها شيء؟
نعم هذا واجب عليك أنك تفقدها وتنظر فيها.
This is obligatory on those who are in charge of the affairs of the people. Meaning governmentally, the government checks on the ra'iyya, on the followers, and every ra'i, every person of responsibility has to watch over those under his flock. So he doesn't do so frivolously. He doesn't do so for entertainment. He does so for the sake of Allah Ta'ala, to protect them from violating the limits of Allah Ta'ala. And very important advice based on that. That if you do this and you find from your children, your adolescent children, for example, misuse of the internet, you find them doing things that are not permissible. You know, I advise myself and all of you to be realistic, to be good parents, not to attack them and not to blast them, but to speak and discuss it with them, to help them recover from these kinds of choices. If you stand by their sides and help them recover from the misuse of the internet, what can we do to fix this? As opposed to saying, shame on you, you're disgusting. How could you look at this filth or something like that? You basically degrade the child and don't give him any way out or any way to recover. But rather you say, what? How do we recover? We make mistakes. We make decisions. We make choices that are wrong in life. We do that all the time. What do we do after we do that? Okay, tawbah, we got repentance. How do we make tawbah from this? What do we do step by step? How do we fix this? Because there's a way to fix it, no matter what they looked at. There's a way to fix it. So don't condemn them. Don't speak down upon them. Don't say words that destroy your relationship with them. But stay with them and say, we seem to have made an error. Yeah? And don't be so shocked that I know about it, because there are government authorities who know about it. There are spies. There are hackers. And most importantly, Rabbul Alameen, the one you return to, the one who, if you fool all of the people on the earth and went undetected with a whole bunch of secret, private sinning. You have to return to him, and the book is laid bare. اِقْرَأْ كِتَابَكَ كَفَى بِنَفْسِكَ الْيَوْمَ عَلَيْكَ حَسِيبًا. Read your own book. You're sufficient as a witness against your own self on this day. So the father who comes, you know, to his teenage son who's made some errors with his use of the internet, and he reminds him like this, this is the good father who's going to aid his son in a real life skill, management of the sins, how to recover, how to be a real person who recovers from the bad choices that we make in life, versus the one who just says, nasty, that's just disgusting, I can't believe my son would do this, and he just speaks with condemning words that don't offer any way out or any guidance. So it's important that we take this approach. If we are doing this, which we should be, following up on our children, watching their moves, and being there to help them make better decisions and recover from bad decisions, that we recover with them like this, hand in hand, not in a condemning way. And Allahu Ta'ala knows best. With that, we'll close our session. And before we do, we'll leave a chance for any errors that were made to be corrected and any questions that need to be asked to be asked. Abdurrahman, if you hear your name when someone's talking. So two people over there, this is Abdurrahman something. We don't know. The other two might be speaking well of him. We don't know it's backbiting. All we heard is something, something, Abdurrahman, something. Right? You're saying something like that, right? You don't know what was said. All right. So they could be praising you. They could be stating a fact about you. They could be backbiting you. What are we going to do about it? Ignore it. Don't worry about it. Yeah, min husni islam al-mar'i tarkuhu ma la ya'nihi. From a person's good Islam is leaving alone the things that don't concern him. No. It's permissible for these two people to have a discussion and you're mentioned in the discussion. It's not necessarily haram. So assume the best about your brother and leave it. That's all. Don't let the shaitan convince you. The shaitan is the one who comes to you and he says they're talking about you, they're backbiting you, they're slandering you because any tahrishun bainakum, that's his job, is to cause fitna and trials between you. So you seek refuge with Allah Ta'ala and you abandon it. So someone comes to you, our brother asks, what if when someone comes to you and says, I heard so-and-so talking bad about you? Who knows? This is very important. Namima, this is a bigger crime than backbiting. This is the crime of namima. This is naqlul hadith min ajal al-ifsad. It is tale carrying, saying, I heard someone speaking bad about you, and he comes to you to tell you. If he was sincere to you, and if he was an honest and upright Muslim, he would have told the person, fear Allah and don't backbite, and he never would have brought it to you. But the fact that he's bringing it to you disqualifies him from having his report even accepted, because he's a namam. He's a tale carrier. Namam is a major sinner. لا يدخل الجنة قتاتا. And remember in this book, in this series, he doesn't enter paradise. He's a major sinner. So now, what's the ruling on قبول قول الفاسق? Accepting the report of an open facet. You don't accept it. It's not acceptable. So he's either lying and that never happened, or he's conveying something that's not permissible to convey to you. In either case, you tell him, fear Allah and leave my presence. Fear Allah and don't ever do that again. Don't ever talk to me like that. Don't ever come to me about some negative speech that you've heard someone saying about me. But rather, if you are a true brother to me, behind my back, then say to them, fear Allah and don't backbite your brother, and never mention that to me. And you remind the people. In general, the facilitator of the backbiting is more sinful than the backbiter. The one who listens to backbiting, he's more severe in sin than the backbiter. How is that? The backbiter, leave him by himself in a room. How will he commit his crime? He needs a facilitator. He needs someone to give that ear and say, yeah, what about him? You know, go ahead and vent. Let me hear what you have to say about so-and-so. And that facilitator now makes this impossible. The backbiter by himself, he cannot backbite. He needs that second party. That second party comes along as al-muta'awin al-ithmi wal-udwan. He's the one who comes to cooperate in sin and transgression. What do you do when you hear backbiting? You say, fear Allah, backbiting is haram. Don't eat the flesh of your dead brother and so on. Use those Quranic warnings. نعم. So kill the backbiting at its source. Don't convey it to someone thinking that to be nasiha. That's not nasiha, that's namima. That's not sincere advice, that's tail carrying. Fear Allah Ta'ala and do not get involved in these things. So someone says, I am avoiding an individual because he's backbitten me. Tayyib, so then we say, how do you know he's backbitten you? How is it that you know? It's possible that you may know by a permissible way, but most likely the way you know is by way of a sinful person that's not to be trusted. So you should ask the person, how do you know he's backbitten you? And trace it. Ahlul Hadith, how is it? Where's your chain of transmission back to him? Because how common is it that we oppress people and we make rulings on people based on what we think they've done without having verified it? I know he's got something against me because I gave him salams and he didn't respond, and we make a judgment. He didn't respond to me because he's avoiding me, because of this, because of that. He must have been talking about me. And we make a verdict upon someone oppressively, and then we think that we have the right to get him back for the evil that he's committed against us, and we've never really traced the chain of narration. We've never really investigated it properly. We've allowed the shaitan to steer us into a number of major sins. So we've got to verify and investigate things. And one of the best ways to verify and investigate things, especially related to rumors and what's been said, he said, she said, is, okay, I need you to go on record with that. So I'm going to pull out my piece of paper here and my pencil. I'm going to write down, Simba told me on this day, what is it that you want to say? And now you feel the pen and the paper is out. I'm on record. I have to be really careful about what I say. It's easy to be loose when there's no pen and paper. But now you've got the pen and paper out. It's a reminder now. You've got to be responsible for these words. So now who are you narrating from? Name him, please. Don't say I heard some people, because this pen and this paper is out for a reason. What are the names of the some people that you're narrating from? Name them for me, please. Right? A person who comes with a correct chain of transmission, he can name for you his men. And that's one of the ways Ahlul Hadith have always killed fitna. They've always killed the spread of innovation. They've always killed the spread of false narrations by asking for the chain of transmission. It is a tool of Ahlul Hadith, subhanAllah, a tool of Ahlul Sunnah, is name your men. When it comes to, I heard so-and-so saying that such and such has happened and there's three or four people in the middle. Okay, give me the chain of transmission. Let's see if it checks out what you're claiming that you have heard and so on. When there's a need to investigate. Pocket dialing, barakallahu fiq. Ahsan, these are good modern issues that definitely have to be brought up. A pocket dial is known as, when our brother's asking about pocket dialing, and is it relevant to these lessons and reminders we've heard tonight? So you get a phone call from someone and you know the caller and you answer, yes. And then all you hear is the rustling noise and the movement of the clothes, or maybe a dialogue between a man and his wife. So now what do? Hang up. You can call him back and tell him you pocket dialed me. Yeah. And then when he sees, look how you are going to earn the respect of your friends. He'll see that the phone call lasted 3 seconds. And he'll say, that's a good brother. He didn't sit on there and listen. When you sit on there and listen, you're on record. He can see that the phone call, if he goes back in his call history, that call was 3.5 minutes. That brother sat there and listened to me. The whole conversation I was having with my wife, he just sat there and listened and didn't even hang up. Didn't have the fear of Allah to just hang up. Subhanallah. So the pocket dial needs to be hung up on, and you can call the person back and say, hey, lock your phone because you're pocket dialing people and I don't want your private issues to spread. Now, jazakallahu khairan, really important. A reminder, then our brother says, just be careful. The 3 minutes that you see on the call record doesn't necessarily mean that he's been listening to the phone call. Maybe it went to his voicemail and it went all that time recording on the voicemail and it wasn't intentional. So be careful and always investigate. Our brother asks, what if it's your wife and she's pocket dialed you? Then it could be that your wife is talking to a sister who is not under your care. You're not privy to her conversation. If you hear your wife talking to your daughter in the family, then this is permissible for you to listen, because these are only people under your care and responsibility. This would be from that angle of listening in on your ra'iyah, on your flock, and checking on them. If it's the case where it's your wife talking to someone else who's not in your family, now what if that person mentioned some private things from her family and now you have no business knowing those things? So it would depend on who's on the line. But the best case is, you know, if you can't recognize who's on the line as being under your responsibility, then you go for the default ruling. Anytime there's any doubt, go back to the default ruling. What's the default ruling? Anyone who listens to any people's speech that they're not pleased with, there's this serious punishment mentioned for that. When there's an exception to a generality, that exception has to be guaranteed. That exception has to be kept to loyally. You can't stretch that exception to include what's not part of it, because now you go into what is under the general prohibition. Wallahu a'lam. Our sisters ask, or one of our sisters ask, what if you talk about other people to your husband? Is that backbiting? Generally, the question looks like that this is backbiting. If you're talking bad about people without justification, with the exceptions to backbiting that are permissible, if you're talking about a child and how to rectify the behavior of a child, and it's negative speech about a child, so a woman talks to her husband about how to fix the behavior problem, that's not impermissible backbiting. That's seeking assistance in changing an evil, which is an exception to the rule of backbiting. But if it's just you're venting against some sisters you're unhappy with to your husband, there's no special exemption that allows you to backbite to your husband. If the backbiting is permissible and justifiable, then it doesn't matter if it's to your husband or to anyone else, then it's permissible. If the backbiting is haram and impermissible and unjustifiable, then it doesn't matter that it's to your husband or anyone else. No, and Allah Ta'ala knows best. This is what Allah Ta'ala has made easy for us this evening. May Allah Ta'ala bless and reward all of you. Wa salli Allahumma wa sallim wa barik ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Ever Merciful. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. All praise is due to Allah, the Lord, Creator and Sustainer of all things. والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين. May Allah raise the rank of and grant peace to His trustworthy messenger, Nabiyyina Muhammadin, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, our Prophet Muhammad, and likewise all of his family and companions. As for what follows, amma ba'd, فَإِنَّ أَصْدَقَ الْحَدِيثِ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ. The best speech is the book of Allah. وَخَيْرَ الْهَدِي هَدْيُ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The very best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad. وَشَرَّ الْأُمُورِ مُحْدَثَاتُهَا. And the worst of all matters are innovations, newly invented matters in the religion. وَكُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ كُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. Every innovation is misguidance. Every misguidance is in the fire. This evening, dear brothers and sisters, locally and online, it is the night preceding the 29th of the month of Jumada al-Akhirah, 1441. 2 months from Ramadan, may Allah Ta'ala give us success in attaining it in safety and in good health. We come together at this time with our local attendees here at Al-Masjid Al-Awwal in the city of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and with our family online as well, to return to our weekly study of 130 hadith on manners. And we have arrived at hadith number 73. Is that right? Hadith number 73. We have studied 72 narrations from the book 130 hadith on manners. And so we are on the hadith of Anas radiyallahu anhu, which has some weakness in it, which will be discussed insha'Allah ta'ala. The hadith is on what page in the workbooks?
105.
Page 105 in the workbooks. We find hadith number 73, wa'an Anasin, and on the authority of Anas radiyallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with him, qala, he said, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the messenger of Allah, may Allah raise his rank and grant him peace, said, طوبى لمن شغله عيبه عن عيوب الناس. Glad tidings, or a tree in paradise, or paradise itself, however you translate the word طوبى, depending on the meaning that you're going to stick with. And the most general one, which includes the others, is glad tidings. Glad tidings of paradise, of a tree in paradise. Glad tidings. Now, For whom? لِمَنْ شَغَلَهُ عَيْبُهُ. His deficiency, his weakness, his weak point keeps him busy عن, from something else. Keeps him busy and occupied away from another matter. عَنْ عُيُوبِ النَّاسِ. From the deficiencies or weak points of the people. Meaning he's focused on himself, finding his flaws, and he's not focused on the flaws of the other people. أخرجه البزار بإسناد حسن. It was collected by البزار with a حسن chain. And even الإمام البزار, he identified the chain of this hadith as being weak when he brought the hadith. In the source book, which is called, anyone know the name of البزار's book? Musnad al-Bazar? Naam. It's known as Musnad al-Bazar. It's also known as Al-Bahru al-Zakhar. Al-Bahru al-Zakhar. Al-Bazar, you don't hear this name too often. Al-Bazar. He was Abu Bakr. His kunya was Abu Bakr. So you have a place for his biography. Make sure you get his name, his kunya, his date of death, all of that. Abu Bakr, Ahmad ibn Amr. Ibn Abd al-Khaliq ibn Khalad al-Ataki al-Bazar. One more time, Abu Bakr, Ahmad ibn Amr. If you just get those two names, that's enough. Ahmad ibn Amr. Ibn Abd al-Khaliq ibn Khalad al-Ataki. He died in the year 292. He has a massive musnad, a big musnad collection, meaning narrations compiled and ordered by what topic? The book called the Musnad has a certain order. And it's not fiqh chapters like Tahara and prayer and zakat. No, some other order that the hadith are ordered by. Narrators. By narrators, yeah, by companions, by chain, you could say. Yeah, all the chains that end with Abu Huraira are in the chapter of Abu Huraira's narrations. Naam, that's how the Musnad of Al-Imam Ahmad is organized. And previously we talked about Al-Mu'jam Al-Kabir of Al-Tabarani, one of the source books quoted. That's also a Musnad. That's also the organization of Musnad, Abi Ya'la Al-Mawsili, and others who wrote books called Musnads. This Musnad is printed in 20 volumes. Two volumes of that are indexes, but 18 volumes for the Musnad of Al-Bazar, printed and available. Alhamdulillah. About 10,000 hadith in this collection. About 10,000 hadith in the collection called Musnad al-Bazar. It's also one of those books that the scholars count as Masadir al-Gharaib, from the source books of strange narrations or narrations that are problematic. And so when it is cited alone as a source and no other information is given, then you assume by default that the narration is problematic, weak, not authentic, until you know otherwise. Like, what other book did we discuss that's like that? If you said it was found in this book and no other information is available, then that indicates that the hadith is probably weak. It's a book by Al-Tabarani, but it's not Al-Mu'jam Al-Kabir. It's Al-Mu'jam Al-Awsat, the middle Mu'jam. Al-Mu'jam Al-Awsat by Al-Tabarani. Other books like Hilyatul Awliya by Abu Nu'aym. If you find narration source to the books of Du'afa, like Ibn Hibban's Majruhin, or Al-Uqayli's Du'afa, or other books that are, the point of the book is to gather narrators who are weak and talk bad about them and warn you against them. So when the hadith is ascribed to that source, do you think it should be authentic? No, the point of the book is to mention to you narrators who are not reliable. And these are their narrations, subhanAllah. So this is one of those books, but we do have a tahseen by Ibn Hajar. We see that Ibn Hajar calls this isnad hasan. And this isnad is not hasan. Sorry, not according to the standards of Ibn Hajar or anyone else. This hadith is weak, and it's quoted as being weak from the source. Back to the source book of Al-Bazar. He says, this hadith is not known to me to be reported except by this chain with its weakness and another chain that goes back to Anas as well. He only knows two chains for it that go back to Anas. And he says that they are da'if, that they are weak. And with that, Shaykh Al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala, has concluded that the hadith is weak. You can refer to his book called Silsilatul Ahadith al-Da'ifa, volume 9, page 299. And in some of his other writings, he mentioned, as other scholars have mentioned, as what Ibn Hajar intends here, that the meaning of this hadith is correct, and there's nothing objectionable about the meaning. While technically we are unable to say that this is established from the speech of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when we go to this hadith and we look at its meaning, we're going to explain it and read the explanation under the clause in sah al khabr, if the hadith is authentic, with other than these chains that we have so far, as they are not authentic in what we have so far. Naam. Just before we mention what Shaykh Saleh al-Fawzan said, we need to talk about one other person, but we've talked about him before. He's Anas ibn Malik. He's quoted as just simply Anas here, and it's known that he's Anas ibn Malik ibn who? An-Nadhar with a Dad. Ibn An-Nadhar with an Alif Lam. Nadhar with a Dad. Is he from the Muhajirin or the Ansar? From the Ansar. He was a young boy from the children of the Ansar, put in the service of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam for the 10 years of Al-Madinah. Since he's from the Ansar, then he should be from either Aus or Khazraj. Which one is he from? Khazraj, barakallahu fikum. And did he live a long life or a short life after the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam? A long life. One of the longest living companions out of all of the companions, subhanAllah, was Anas ibn Malik. Do you know when he died? Beyond the year 90. So we're talking about 80 years of life after the death of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And it was said that he became very affluent, very wealthy. He was a blessed individual because he spent his youth in the service of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It's been reported that he had as many as 40 sons and a large amount of property, wealth, and all of that, and he left a massive inheritance behind him, radiyallahu anhu. So we've talked about the companion who reported the hadith, we've talked about the collector who gathered the hadith, and now let's read the explanation of Shaykh Saleh ibn Fawzan ibn Abdullah al-Fawzan from his book Ithaful Kiram, and I'm reading from page number 202 of that book, which is an explanation of these 130 hadith. You can also find his explanation, the same one, printed as the last volume of his entire explanation of the source book of these 130 hadith, Bulugh al-Maram by Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar. He says, Tuba, the word Tuba means shajaratun fil jannah, a tree in paradise. Takunu liman shagalahu aibuhu an uyubin nasi. It is for a person who his own flaws keep him busy and occupied from following up on the flaws of others. يَنْظُرُ فِي عُيُوبِهِ هُوَ وَيُصْلِحُهَا. He looks at his own flaws and he rectifies them. وَيُحَاسِبُ نَفْسَهُ. And he takes his own self to account. Meaning before he is taken to account. The intelligent one is the one who takes his own self to account before he is made to account for himself on the Day of Judgment. وَلَا يَشْتَغِلُ بِعُيُوبِ النَّاسِ. And he doesn't busy himself with the flaws of the people. وَيَغْفُلُ عَنْ عُيُوبِهِ. Whilst he ignores his own flaws. فَالَّذِي يَشْتَغِلُ بِعُيُوبِهِ وَيَتْرُكُ عُيُوبَ النَّاسِ. The one who focuses on his own flaws and he leaves the flaws of other people. هَذَا لَهُ هَذَا الْوَعْدُ الْكَرِيمُ أَنَّ لَهُ طُوبَى. This is the person who has this generous reward in store for him, and that is that he shall have tuba wa hiya shajaratun fil jannah, and it is a tree in paradise. Yasirur raqibu fi dhilliha masirata mi'ati 'amin. A rider would ride 100 years of journey in its shade. That's how expansive this one tree is in the paradise, and may Allah Ta'ala allow us to enjoy its shade. Aw kama ja'a, Shaykh Saleh al-Fawzan says, or however it has come, meaning with the accurate description of its size, and that is accurate based on narrations found in Sahih ibn Hibban and elsewhere. وَقِيلَ طُوبَى هِيَ الْجَنَّةِ. And it's also been said that طُوبَى it is Jannah itself. It is a name of paradise. Tuba is paradise. And thirdly, it's been said, and I'm adding this, that it is Bushra. Tuba means glad tidings. And there's no contradiction between any of these. Because if Tuba is established in the texts as a tree in paradise, then you can refer to paradise by one of the things in paradise, by saying Jannah is Tuba. And you can say, telling someone that they shall have Tuba, that tree, and paradise, that is Bushra, that is glad tidings. All of those meanings work together, and there is no clash so as to have a need to decide which one is correct. هذا الحديث فيه فضيلة الإنسان الذي يشتغل بعيوب نفسه. This hadith has within it the virtue of a person who focuses on and busies himself with, occupies himself with his own personal flaws. وَيُصْلِحُهَا, and he corrects them. وَلَا يَشْتَغِلُ بِعُيُوبِ النَّاسِ, and he does not busy himself with the faults of the people. وَفِيهِ ذَمُّ الْعَكْسِ, and it also has in this hadith a dispraise of the opposite. وَهُوَ الَّذِي يَشْتَغِلُ بِعُيُوبِ النَّاسِ, that's the one who's busy, focused on the faults of the people. وَيَنْسَى عَيْبَ نَفْسِهِ, and at the same time he forgets his own faults. Subhanallah. That's the end of the explanation. This hadith is very much relative to the last hadith we studied. Who can cite the last hadith we studied and explain the connection? All you have to do is flip back one page. It's not a big journey. Flip back to hadith number 72. Look at it and then tell me what's the connection between hadith 72 and today's hadith 73. The one who listens in, he eavesdrops. What's the punishment? Molten lead is poured into his ears on the day of judgment. Tayyib, why is he eavesdropping? Mushtaghilun bi'uyubin nas. Because he's busy with the faults of the other people. He's not listening to hear something good and be happy. He's a sinful person. So he's overtaken by negativity and pessimism. He thinks poorly of people. He's eavesdropping, it's impermissible, and he's blameworthy for that. A major sinner that shall have this threat upon him on the day of judgment. So therefore, he's not listening, he's not eavesdropping with a good intention. He's not eavesdropping to hear good things and spread good things. He's eavesdropping to hear faults and flaws and problems and fitna and sins and things he can spread to be against people. That's the whole point of the eavesdropper. He is busy looking for the faults of other people. So he doesn't get the tuba. The one who eavesdrops, he's busy trying to find problems and mistakes with others. And he doesn't get the tuba. He doesn't get the paradise, the tree in paradise. That is for those who, they themselves have become occupied finding their own faults and treating their own faults and correcting and solving their own problems and not focused on the other people. We've also had a very important staple hadith that I think we talked about in our last week's class as well. This hadith comes under that generality. The correct meaning of this hadith that we cannot say is actually attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because of the chain of transmission not being up to par according to the standards of the scholars of hadith. So there is another hadith that this comes under the generality of, which is authentic, and it's a pillar of our practice of Islam, a pillar in manners. Min husni Islam al-mar'i ahsant tarkuhu ma la ya'nihi. From the good Islam of a person is that he leaves alone the things that are none of his business, things that do not concern him. Meaning things that are outside of his responsibility that he has not been asked to follow up on, he has not been asked to correct and oversee and supervise that group of people over there. So then he doesn't focus on them. He focuses on what he has been made accountable for and what he is responsible for. Subhanallah. So that hadith, where is it found? In Al-Arba'een. What's the source of the hadith? Muslim. Are you sure? Is that a guess? That's incorrect. Not found in Sahih Muslim. At-Tirmidhi. Barakallahu feekum. And who's the narrator? Now it's time to guess. Now you do that default guess. Abu Huraira. Yes, that's correct. Barakallahu fikum. So it's collected by a Tirmidhi from the report of Abu Huraira. What number is that hadith in our collection? It's in our collection. Did you forget, Ya Sultan? Where is it? And how can we find it? Use your index on page 196 and look for the hadith of Abu Huraira. Min husni Islam al-mar'i tarkuhu ma la ya'nihi. You found it? 38. Barakallahu fiikum. So then you can review that hadith and its explanation. It is hadith number 38 out of our 130 hadith. Barakallahu fiikum. A very important hadith that I've mentioned before that helps us not overlook an important thing that someone might mistakenly arrive at if they're not paying close attention to the real meaning of the hadith. Someone might say, this encouragement we've heard today means leave alone the people. Don't order good. Don't forbid evil. Don't correct mistakes. Don't advise. Don't guide the people. Don't warn the people against evil. Just focus on yourself, right? Someone might hear this hadith today and grab onto it, you know, really tightly without knowing its full meaning, and then say, you know, طُوبَ لِمَنْ شَغَلَهُ عَيْبُهُ عَنْ عُيُوبِ النَّاسِ, whenever he's approached with good advice in the religion. Imagine a brother loves his brother for the sake of Allah. He sees something that's not befitting for a believer to do, so he comes to him with this brotherly love and concern. And he says, dear brother, Allah Ta'ala has forbidden us from this action here. Maybe we should think about an alternative and try to replace it with some other action. And he says, Tuba. He says to him, Tuba. He brings out this hadith to repel the nasiha. Like, get away from me with that, right? Focus on yourself. Glad tidings for you if you just focus on your own business and you leave me alone. Tayyib, let's go to that narration which is found in the Sunan of Abi Dawood, and it's authentic. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he reached a time in his caliphate where the people misunderstood this issue, and they focused heavily on self-rectification without enjoining good and forbidding the evil, and they began to leave off enjoining the good and forbidding the evil. So he wanted to correct it, and he wanted to bring them back to the proper balance. So he said, أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ, he addressed the people, O people, إِنَّكُمْ تَقْرَؤُونَ هَذِهِ الْآيَةِ, you are reading this verse, وَتَضَعُونَهَا عَلَى غَيْرِ مَوَاضِعِهَا, and you are placing it in other than its proper place. Then he read the verse from Surah Al-Ma'idah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ, O you who believe, upon you is to take care of your own selves. لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ مَنْ ضَلَّ إِذَا اهْتَدَيْتُمْ, you will not be harmed by anyone who goes astray so long as you are rightly guided. إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ جَمِيعًا, unto Allah is the return of all of you. فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ, and he will inform you about that which you used to do. So he rehearses the ayat to them that they have misunderstood because they have not upheld the duty of enjoining good, forbidding evil, and advising. And they're sticking to what seems to be the apparent meaning of this verse. Alaykum anfusakum. Just take care of your own selves only. Don't worry about what's beyond your walls and so on. So he said, you're reading this verse. He said, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, مَا مِن قَوْمٍ يُعْمَلُ فِيهِم بِالْمَعَاصِي, there are no people that have disobedience being done in their midst, among them, ثُمَّ يَقْدِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَن يُغَيِّرُوا, whilst they are then able, they are capable of changing that evil, meaning either by hand or by tongue. They're able to do something and change that evil. ثُمَّ لَا يُغَيِّرُوا, and then they don't change it, along with the قُدْرَ, with the ability. إِلَّا يُوشِكُ أَن يَعُمَّهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْهُ بِعِقَابِ, except that it is about to be, or it is almost taking place, that Allah will cover them all with a punishment from himself. That hadith was collected by Imam Abu Dawood in his Sunan, and it is authentic. It sort of redirects us to, yes, we focus on ourselves, but no, we are not allowed to abandon enjoining good and forbidding evil, and the deen is nasiha, right? The entire religion is nasiha. And Allah Ta'ala has said, واتقوا فتنة لا تصيبن الذين ظلموا منكم خاصة. And be afraid of a fitna that does not befall only the oppressive ones among you exclusively. Meaning, the punishment from Allah Ta'ala that overtakes the people when evil is being done and they don't enjoin good or forbid evil. They don't advise within the legislated parameters of advice in Islam. Then there is fitna that is coming for them when they abandon enjoining good and forbidding evil. And that verse is in Surah Al-Anfal. One last question about this hadith for this evening, and we'll suffice with this insha'Allah Ta'ala. And that is, you've heard recently in a khutbah, the hadith which is found in Sahih Muslim, from the report of Abu Hurairah radiyallahu anhu, that he said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, بَدَأَ الْإِسْلَامُ غَرِيبًا وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا كَمَا بَدَأَ فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَ. Islam began as something strange, and it shall return to being something strange. So tuba, this reward, if it is a specific reward of a tree, a specific tree in paradise that is not for everyone, but it is a promised reward for people who fulfill certain things. Tuba is for the strangers, meaning those who are upon the original strangeness of Islam that it began with, the worship of Allah Ta'ala alone and the practice of the deen with sincerity and everything that comes under that. Are they two different rewards for two different virtuous actions, and the people who do them get the same reward? Or are they the same people? Are the ghuraba the people mentioned in today's hadith, in sah al-khabr, if the hadith is authentic? Can they be the same people? The ghuraba, from their goodness, from the way they practice Islam with sincerity, is they have a great focus on their own faults, treating their own faults, rectifying their own selves before rectifying others. And that actually comes in one of the narrations collected by Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, when they asked in this narration, "Man humul ghuraba ya Rasulullah?" Who are the ghuraba, O Messenger of Allah? He said, "Alladhina yasluhuna idha fasada an-nasu." They are the ones that are righteous themselves when the people are corrupt. The one who focuses on himself and doesn't focus on others. The others have become corrupt and he is focused devoutly on rectifying himself. So he's from the ghuraba. Naam, especially in our time, subhanAllah. How often is it the case? Listen to the conversations of the people. You will not sit at a bus stop except someone will say, Trump. Someone will say this name and that name and these leaders and those leaders and these people and what they should do and how, you know, everyone's busy with what's wrong with everybody else. What so-and-so needs to do is this, and what he needs to do is this, and what she needs to do is this. And the strangest of all things that I've seen, you go into the prisons, go into the darkest place of the prison where people are under so many levels of punishment. Go into what's called the RHU, Restricted Housing Units, informally known as the hole. Go in there, the bottom of the worst place you can go. There's nowhere below it to go. You're in jail, in jail. You're in jail, and then they put you in jail. You're in the hole. And when I go to the door sometimes to talk to some of these brothers, some of the, you know, Muslims even, they'll say, "I can't believe, for example, my sister's getting married. I told her this man is no good for her. And I can't believe she's ruining her life. And I sent her so much clarity on this issue and she will not listen to me. I don't know what's wrong with her." What's going on here? There is a great need to rectify something, and that's being overlooked. And we're focused on, subhanAllah, what other people are doing wrong in their lives. And this, it's really an illness that it can take a person that far. His whole life being ruined and wrecked to this degree, and he's still saying, "This person is not doing the right thing, and that person, and that person, and that person." And as for me, I've just been oppressed by everybody. Everyone's, you know, attacking me and doing wrong to me. And there's nothing really that I need to treat here. There's nothing here that needs rectified, but rather everybody else in my life is causing problems and mistreating me and oppressing me. And that's how far it can take you. It can take you that far that you have totally forgotten yourself. And when you forget yourself and you are focused on others, then know that Allah Ta'ala has made you like that because of your disobedience. Think carefully, because Allah Ta'ala has told us in the book, this is the reality of those who are disobedient to Him and they don't remember Allah. They don't obey Allah and keep mindful of Allah. وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ. And don't be like the people who have forgotten Allah. They don't mention Allah. They don't observe His limits in their lives. Maybe they come to the masjid and they're pious, but the house has no Islam in it. The house has a car, whatever. I'll buy the car on whatever financing deal that makes the most sense to me. Islamic rulings, what's halal, what's haram. Credit card, who cares? I'm getting a credit card. Mortgage the house, who cares? Finance the car, who cares? Contracts and deals and partnerships in business and what's halal, what's haram. The person just doesn't care. And then his life is a wreck, subhanAllah, as a result. He has forgotten Allah Ta'ala. وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ. What's the result? فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنفُسَهُمْ. Don't be like those who have forgotten Allah, meaning they disobey Allah Ta'ala and don't apply His rulings. And He made them forget their own selves. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. Such are the disobedient people. So it is because of fisk, because of disobedience, because of ghafla, وَالْإِعْرَاضِ, because of heedlessness and turning away from the orders of Allah Ta'ala, that Allah will make you forget your own self. فَإِذَا أَنْسَاكَ اللَّهِ نَفْسَكَ. So if Allah has made you to forget your own self, then you have a focus. You're going to focus on something. What are you going to focus on? عُيُوبُ النَّاسِ. You'll be busy with the faults of the people. Because why? Allah has made you forget your own self because of your own sinfulness. We ask Allah Ta'ala to save us from the evil of our own souls. Allahumma ameen. This is what He has made easy for us this evening. I hope that Allah Ta'ala has made some benefit in what we've come together to review. And if there's a correction to an error that I've made, or a question or comment or contribution to this evening's class, we'll take it at this time just before we close, insha'Allah Ta'ala. One manifestation that our brother mentions here is the focus that a lot of the people have on the Muslim rulers. It's just one of the many focuses of Uyub al-Nas. We're focused on what the people are doing. And as the people are, they will be ruled. Your leaders are flawed. Your leaders are, you know, they have acts of disobedience. They do things that are not pleasing to Allah Ta'ala because we are flawed. As a community, we are flawed. And we have the leaders that we deserve, and all of that is from the command of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Allah has legislated for us nasiha to be delivered to them. He has made their nasiha, advice directed to them, of a special category that is mentioned before the advice that is due to every single Muslim. In the famous hadith of Ad-Din al-Nasiha, the religion is sincerity and sincerity of purpose. قَالُوا لِمَنْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. They said, to whom is it due, O Messenger of Allah? قَالَ لِلَّهِ وَلِكِتَابِهِ وَلِرَسُولِهِ. It is due to Allah, to His book, and to His messenger. That is sincerity to Allah, sincerity to the book of Allah, sincerity to the messenger of Allah. وَلِأَئِمَّةِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. And to the imams of the Muslims, the leaders of the Muslims, وَعَمَّتِهِمْ, and their common folk. بَارَكَ اللَّهُ فِيكُمْ. This is extremely important. The status that Allah Ta'ala has given the leaders cannot be neglected, and advice is given to them in the very best and most secure way, that which brings about the very best result. Like we would not appreciate if someone just blasted us about every fault we have in front of the people, and we probably wouldn't respond too well to that. If you are called out at Jumu'ah time by name, this guy is doing this, and named and disgraced in front of everyone, you would probably never want to come back around your brothers here in this masjid. If that was the way we corrected people, by blasting them openly and publicly, generally people don't take to that too well. So what about the leaders of the people? They require, or they deserve, based on the book and the sunnah, a higher level of regard about how that advice is delivered. And just like your own brother in this city, that you don't have access to, you don't work with him and you don't see him, maybe you only see him once a year, you wish you had a chance to say something to him, but every time you see him, he's gone, so you don't have access to him, then your accountability is over. And if you could sit with him, to addi ma alayk, you would deliver the advice you have for him. When you can't sit with him and you never see him, then what are you going to do? Make dua for him to be rectified. Try your best. If Allah Ta'ala doesn't make it easy for you, then you're not sinful and you're not blameworthy. You haven't been made responsible for overseeing everyone and following up on every little thing. In this city, nor in this country, nor in the entire world especially. And from the ways the shaitan gets the people is that he gets them busy correcting the world and their houses falling apart. He gets the people busy thinking they're going to correct the world and their own houses are falling apart. Yet Allah Ta'ala says, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Allah has promised the believers who do righteous deeds, لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. He is certainly going to give them authority in the land. كَمَا اسْتَخْلَفَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. Just as he gave authority to those before them. وَلَيُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمُ الَّذِي ارْتَضَى لَهُمْ. And he is certainly going to provide them with the ability to practice their religion that he is pleased with for them. وَلَيُبَدِّلَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنَا. And he is going to exchange for them their state of fear for security. يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا. They worship me alone and they don't commit any polytheism. That is a description of those whom Allah Ta'ala grants authority to. He enables them to practice their religion. He gives them prosperity upon the religion. Do we have this today? Do we have authority and do we have, you know, dignity and prosperity in the Muslim lands? Or are we humiliated and disgraced in many of the Muslim lands? You look at the world and you see. So what is the cause of this disgrace and this humiliation? It's the distance of the Muslims at large from understanding and actualizing Tawheed. It is the Quburiyya that is widespread, the fanaticism about the graveyards. It is the Sufi exaggerations about saints and calling upon them and taking them as intermediaries, and all of that is polytheism. وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. The masjids and the body parts for prostration, they are all for Allah. So do not call upon anyone besides Allah in your supplication. With widespread violations of Tawheed, Muslims being entertained by magic, which is apostasy, Muslims being entertained by soothsayers and horoscopes, and all kinds of violations of Tawheed left and right, all over the world, in the Muslim lands. And then we see humiliation being put upon us. Subhanallah. The disobedience of the Muslims in their lack of willingness to apply Islamic rules in their families, between a husband and a wife, in the business, in the transactions, all of that. It is disgrace and humiliation that is the result of this neglect. And so therefore, what's the solution? Is the solution to raise our voices about the leader and get him out? And force him out? That's been done in many countries. They have raised their voices. And they have chanted in the streets. And they have ousted their rulers. So what happened? Everything's better now? Problem solved. We got that leader out. He was causing all the problems. What happened? Worse. Because why? They didn't rectify themselves. They just demanded that the leader leave. That doesn't fix the problem. You don't deserve now from Allah Ta'ala leadership that's righteous. Rather, you deserve what's worse than you already had, because you're disobeying Allah Ta'ala and your methodology, and you're contradicting the Prophet's methodology of change, and you're overlooking your own faults and not correcting what's in front of you right on your plate, and you're thinking beyond that and you're trying to correct what is outside of your obligation and what's outside of your authority and your ability to correct. And therefore Allah Ta'ala punishes us by disgracing us further. Think about the narration that's quoted often by our scholars. إِذَا تَبَايَعْتُمْ بِالْعِينَ. When you engage in عِينَ transactions, that is, deceptive transactions to get around the rules of riba, you know, to try to rename riba, usury, other names, to do it. You want to do it, but you You don't want to call it riba. إِذَا تَبَعْيَعْتُمْ بِالْعِينَ وَأَخَذْتُمْ بِأَذْنَابِ الْبَقَرِ And you hold on to the tails of cows. وَرَلِيتُمْ بِالزَّرْعِ And you're pleased with agriculture. وَتَرَكْتُمُ الْجِهَادَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ And you abandon military participation in the way of Allah. When you do these four things, what happens? سَلَّطَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ ذُلًّا Allah Ta'ala sends down upon you disgrace. لَا يَنْزِعُهُ عَنْكُمْ حَتَّى تَرْجِعُوا إِلَى دِينِكُمْ He does not remove it. Not the Jews of the nation called Israel, mistakenly. Not the disbelievers of the American government. Not the disbelievers in India or the Chinese government. Allah Ta'ala doesn't remove the humiliation until you return back to your religion, meaning to obedience and submission and compliance to the orders of Allah Ta'ala, sincerity, not playing tricks with the laws of Islam, trying to avoid the naming of riba, but still taking part in usury, subhanAllah. When you remove these insincerities in your practice, and when we as a people better ourselves and remind ourselves and grow to what is better with Allah Ta'ala, then we deserve better from Allah Ta'ala. And Allah is not heedless of what we do. And Allah Ta'ala is not unaware. Allah Ta'ala knows who deserves honor and distinction. And Allah Ta'ala grants it to them in this life and in the hereafter. And Allah Ta'ala knows who deserves disgrace and humiliation. And He puts it on them. The affair is with Allah Ta'ala. We are His worshippers. This is what we come together to support each other in doing, so that we deserve better as an ummah. We have to think every time I am insincere, every time I disobey, every time I think I'm away from the eyes of the people, so I go and do whatever I'm going to do, I'm part of the humiliation of the whole ummah with my actions. I'm not just an individual making an individual decision. I'm part of an ummah that is being in this time that we live in disgraced all over the planet. And why am I confident that I sneak off on the side and disobey Allah Ta'ala and this doesn't have any impact on the situation that we're talking about now? Rather, we struggle and we strive and we repent from our violations and from our insincerity and from our negligence. And we hope that that and what we cooperate with our brothers upon in doing likewise, that that would enable us to deserve what is better with Allah Ta'ala, the one who in His hand is the affair of all matters in this life. Who is honored and who is disgraced. And we ask Allah Ta'ala to honor us with Islam and the Sunnah and the following of the way of the Salaf and to distance us from the disgrace of innovations and the disgrace of apostasy and the disgrace of disobedience and hypocrisy. Wallahu a'lam wa salli Allahumma wa sallim wa barik ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.